Bed, bed, it's time to get in bed. No, 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 I don't want to get in bed. Please, please, sleep is good for you. No, 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 I don't like it, you. Bed, bed, it's time to get in bed. No, 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 I don't want to get in bed. Please, please, sleep is good for you. No, 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 I don't like it, you. Bed, bed, it's time to get in bed. No, 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 I don't want to get in bed. Please, please, sleep is good for you. No, 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 I don't like it, you. Bed, bed, it's time to get in bed. No, 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 I don't want to get in bed. Please, please, sleep is good for you. No, 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 I don't like it, you.
They remembered seeing Nelson Mandela's funeral on TV. The problem was that he was actually still alive. He died in 2013. How might something like that have happened with the spelling of the word dilemma? Well, one theory is that it's easy to think events actually happened the way we'd expect to see them. Anyone who's ever missed a typo in their own writing will know what it feels like to see the spelling you expect to see. So, I wonder whether the spelling problem...
The feelings of the scenes and the intuition. Sense perceptions are sense deceptions. Sense perceptions are sense deceptions, Descartes. Despite the denials of the Berkeley, the qualifications of Hume, and the reservations of the Heraclitus, Plato, Kant, and Mill concerning what we can know about the external world, physicists and mathematicians do believe that there is an external world. Really? They would argue that even if all human beings were suddenly wiped out, the external world, physical world, would continue to exist. When a tree crashes to the ground in a forest, a sound is created even if no one is there to hear it. We have five senses: sight, hearing, touch, taste, and smell, and each of these constantly receives messages from this external world. Whether or not our sensations are reliable, we do receive them from some external source. For practical reasons, such as remaining alive and possibly for improving life in the external world, we certainly want to know as much as possible about this world. Yeah. We must distinguish land from sea. We must grow food, build shelters, and protect ourselves against wild beasts. Why then can we not rely on our senses to achieve these aims? Primitive civilizations have done so. But, just as to the pure in heart the world is pure, so to the simple-minded the world is simple. In attempting to improve our material way of life, we were forced to extend our knowledge of the external world. Thus, we necessarily extended the uses of our senses to the utmost. Unfortunately for us, our senses are not only limited but also deceiving. Yeah. Trusting solely in the sense can even lead to disaster. Let us note some of these limitations. Of the five senses, the sense of sight is perhaps the most variable. Right. Let us first test how much we can depend on this sense. We begin with a few simple examples. Through the years, many deceptive visual figures were deliberately conceived and constructed to show the limitation of the eye. In fact, physicists and astronomers of the 19th century took a lively interest in the visual illusions because they were concerned that visual observations might prove to be unreliable. William Undt, an assistant of the famous physiologist, physician, and scientist Hermann von Helmholtz, 1821 to 1894, constructed the figure 1. Yes, please look at figure 1. Figure 1 is just a horizontal line plus vertical line. So it is reverse T character letters. The illusion is simply that the vertical line looks longer than the horizontal line, which is of equal length. Oh, really? Yes. Vertical line looks longer than the horizontal line. Wow. This illusion can be reserved. In the figure 2, the height and width seem equal, but the width is larger. Really? Wow. So cool. Yeah, it looks like so. The illusion in figure 3 was devised by Franz Müller Rayer in 1899, and it's also known as the Ernest Mach illusion. The two horizontal lines are actually the same length. Really? Light one looks much shorter. Okay, there is two lines. Large, small, along? Anyway. In figure 4, the dot is at the middle of the horizontal line. Both illusions are created by angles. Really? Yes. Wow. In figure 5, the length of the top horizontal line of the lower figure appears shorter than that of the top line of the upper figure. Incidentally, it is difficult to believe that the maximum horizontal width of the lower figure is as great as the maximum height of that figure. Wow, seriously, Hugh? A striking illusion involving the influence of the angle is shown in the figure 6. Yes, diagonals AB and AC of the two parallelograms are of equal length, but the one on the right appears much shorter. Seriously? Wow. If oblique lines are extended across vertical ones, as in figure 7, the illusion is very striking. The oblique line on the right, if extended, would meet the upper end of the oblique line on the left. However, the apparent point of intersection is somewhat lower. This well-known illusion is attributed to the Johann P. Poggendorf, about 1860. Wow.
What's new, you'd say, what's not be wop. The show has also coined a number of words and meanings over the years. There's trestling, a game that has opponents play Tetris with one hand.
In figure 8, the three horizontal lines are of equal length, although they appear unequal. Yes, they are pretty much different, looks like. This illusion is primarily a result of sizes of the angles made by the lines at the end. Within the certain limits, the greater the angle, the greater is the apparent elongation of the central horizontal portion. Wow. A striking illusion of the contrast is shown in the figure 9. Yes. Wow. The central circle of the two figures are equal, although the one surrounded by the large circle appears much smaller than the one surrounded by the smaller circle. Yes. Wow. It's totally different. You. Another mechanism is believed to be at work in the Müller-Rayer illusion. In the left drawing of the figure 10, the horizontal line at each end of the vertical line A are interpreted as the upper and lower edges of the two walls meeting at the corner. In the case, the vertical line would be interpreted as being the foreground of the real world scene. In the light drawing of figure 10, the horizontal lines are again seen as the wall edges. But in this case, they appear to be converging on an inside corner. As a result, the vertical line B is interpreted as being in the background. the judgment of the size constantly then enlarges the perceived length of the line B and diminishes line A. Yo! Johann Z. Zullner was the first to describe the illusion illustrated in the figure 11. Yes. And 12. Zullner accidentally noticed the illusion on a pattern designed for dress goods. Yes, the long parallel line in the figure 11 appear to diverge, whereas in the figure 12 they appear to converge. Wow, this is how dress design works, right? This is how designer designs the dresses, right? You. It's called wisdom, isn't it? Wow, I'm so excited. In the herring illusion, figure 13. Just a moment.
This is Travis from Dallas, Texas. And our family story comes from our 3-year-old son who is learning vocabulary. And he has a way of describing things that have happened before today. And that is with the word lasterday. And so he'll say to us, questioning us, kind of confirming things that he thinks happened before today.
In the Herring illusion, figure 13, published in the 1861 by Ewald Herring, the straight horizontal line acquires the illusion of the curving in relation to the converging oblique lines. Okay. Wow, yes. The unreliability of the vision is demonstrated by still another example devised by the Professor S. Tolansky in the figure 14. Okay. Commonly used in the statistical studies, the baseline CD is as long as the height of the figure. Moreover, a viewer, when asked to draw a line across the curve that is half the width of the baseline, would almost surely choose the line AB. However, the correct choice is XY. Really? Wow. We are all familiar with an illusion that is deliberately and skillfully fashioned, namely realistic painting. The intent is to present a three-dimensional scene on a flat or two-dimensional canvas. One of the great achievements of the Renaissance painters was to devise a mathematical scheme known as a linear perspective, which achieves the desired illusion. Wow. Some simple examples of the illusion of the linear perspective are part of our everyday experience. The principle involved in these examples and in the theory of the linear perspective is that the lines in the actual scene that recede directly from the observer must appear to come together at a distant point called the vanishing point. Yes. A simple example is finished by the appearance of the two parallel railroad tracks, figure 15, yes, that appear to meet at a distant point, yes. They meet each other at the end, right? They look like so.
What advice can I share? When I got my undergraduate degree in English, I had no idea how to get a job. None. I was the first person in my family to graduate from college, so getting the degree was the big goal for me. Nobody gave me much career counseling, and I didn't know enough to look for it myself. I struggled to find a job, and I was really close to having to move back home to live with my parents. I worked in direct sales for a while and then landed a job at an insurance brokerage owned by my friend's father. They were nice people and I was incredibly grateful to have a job and I liked working there, but it wasn't what I wanted to do forever. At the same time, I had a friend who had just graduated with a political science degree and had started working for political groups and writing pieces that were getting placed in newspapers. I was astonished. I mean, I was the writer. I was the one who had written for the school paper in high school and college. Upon reflection, I decided his biggest advantage was that he had a niche, politics. He had something to write about. And I didn't. It took me many more years and a roundabout path, but I finally ended up with a master's in biology and as much work as I could handle as a science writer and editor. Learning to write about something complicated turned out to be an especially great edge because not many people can understand medicine and biology and write well. You actually don't need an advanced degree to become a science writer, or I imagine a writer in any complicated field. But if you're just starting out, immersing yourself in a difficult field so you can write about it intelligently and with insight is a path I recommend. You'll have less competition, and these tend to be smaller universes. So once you get a little experience, it'll be easier to network. When you're just getting started, you need to look for an opening. For me, a laboratory fire at UC Santa Cruz was my first big break. It got me my first freelance writing assignment for the magazine The Scientist. I heard about the fire from a friend on campus, and I immediately cold called the editorial offices at The Scientist. Because